So glad. Hello, my name is Abdullah Spinger, and this is my best friend, Fuad Salim.
Hi.
Nobody told me to feel so good. Nobody said you'd be so beautiful. Nobody warned me about your smile. You're the light when I close my eyes. I'm gonna die. You make me colorblind.
We are both from Afghanistan. And we have been living in Scotland, in Glasgow, for more than 2 years now.
We didn't know each other before we came to Scotland, but when we found out that we live in the same blocks of flats, now we are like brothers.
When I think about all of the things that I feel I lack.
We love living in here because at last we have safe and secure life, and at least we don't have to worry about dead bodies lying around the streets.
It was really great to find a friend who's seen all the horrible things that I have seen. Because we were able to help each other. A lot of people in Scotland still don't understand why most of the asylum seekers are coming here. And a lot of people in Scotland, I think they don't like us very much. So this is why we are making this film, to show them who we are and why we are so grateful to live in Scotland. So, this is our story.
The funny thing is, Scots language. Well, they speak. No, they don't speak English, but they speak Scottish, you know.
They swallow the tea. See you later. Eat mean, how are you in here?
What?
I just go like, you know, honestly, that's what it is. Eat, if they say eat, that means how are you? But they, if they say quick, you know, alright mate, you know, you don't understand it, obviously.
Well, after 3 minutes, we got used to Scottish language, but now, well, that time was really
3 minutes or 3 months?
3 months, sorry.
You said 3 minutes. Goodness.
No,
so quick, this guy. Genius.
So after 3 minutes, we got used to the Scottish language, but the first time we...
You get hit throughout 3 minutes?
Months, or say. Months. Okay. You wee beard there.
Yeah.
And you need a shave.
Too easy.
You need a shave.
I shaved this morning.
Oh, yeah.
It's my father. It's my little sister, Yusra.
Hello.
When we came here, we were six. Now we are seven because we got a Scottish sister. I've got one. I've got two brothers, two sisters, mom and dad. When I first stepped in the house, you know, I felt safe.
This is my other sister. You are very happy today?
Yes.
So happy?
Yes.
Why?
Because I like it.
You like it?
Yes. I like it happy.
All right.
Today is such a nice day. My mother and my sisters are away for a walk outside. It's unusual, you know, having weather like this in Scotland. So today's a very good weather. It's really nice.
We like our house because it is safe and secure, but it's very small for 9 of us. Me, my mom, my dad, my 4 brothers and my 2 sisters.
Really sure.
There are only 3 small bedrooms for us. I share the bedroom with my brothers, but 2 of the beds are broken. We don't have any room to have a proper table to eat our dinner like we used to have in Afghanistan. But at least we don't have bombs going off outside, so we are very grateful for this house, as they say in Scotland. When I was 4 years old in Afghanistan, I loved going to school, but I was only there for 6 months. One day the soldiers came and told all of the pupils and all of the teachers to leave the school or they would be killed. One of our teachers refused to leave, so they killed her. So after that, we couldn't go to school anymore. The soldiers stole everything out of the school and damaged all the buildings. It felt like the end of my life. That's why for me, it's a dream to be at Drumchapel High School. I love it there. When I got a letter saying that I was going to go there, that was the happiest day of my life. Because at last, I was going to get the education which I had been denied in Afghanistan.
The first day I was really excited. I was ready with everything, you know, my jotters and pencil. Couldn't believe my eyes, you know, I couldn't believe that I was in school. And it was my dream, you know, came true. I just wanted to shout to everybody, you know, I'm in school.
The teachers are really kind to us. In the bilingual unit, they work very hard with us to help us improve our English so that we can then go into all the other classes with everybody else.
I learned English, like, I was staying at 3 o'clock in the morning. I was watching the films. Any film comes up, I was watching. So I had to write them down and go into school and ask. So like 6 months, I was just wanted to learn English so I can help myself. It was hard, but it was worth it.
In 2 years, I have achieved 2 certificates, and it is all thanks to the teachers. They have given up their own time to help us. I'm very proud of all my teachers, but I don't want to name any names in case I miss anybody out.
Would you like to be a sergeant?
No country would have me.
They wouldn't accept you.
I'd be sitting in a wee camp somewhere, you know, waiting to get in.
Sir, why?
I'll tell you a Glasgow joke then, right?
Okay.
This wee boy comes home with an armchair under one arm, an armchair under another arm, and a sofa strapped to his back.
Right.
And his father gives him into a really terrible row and says to him, "How many times have I told you not to accept sweets from strangers? Do you know what a three-piece sweet is?"
Yeah.
2 chairs and a sofa. Oh, never mind it. It loses a lot when you have to explain it, you know.
What do you think of asylum seekers coming to the school?
Asylum seekers, to me, have been a great, great asset to the school. You two particularly have been very good ambassadors for the asylum seekers because you've got on very, very well with the pupils. We've also got pupils as well who have been eager to make asylum seeker pupils feel welcome. I think this is something that we've got and we should really treasure in this school. It's taken away the sort of fear that some people have about having people from other countries living in their city and going to their school. And by and large, it's not... We've not had any problems or nothing serious.
Did you have that fear?
Did I have that fear?
Scared of science.
I have a fear every minute of the day when I know I'm going to have you two in the class.
And seriously, in my experience, because you value the opportunity of an education, by doing so, you've set a good example to others. And much as I hate to admit it, you're actually a pleasure to teach. And I have to say, I've learned quite a bit from you two.
It brings out the best in us. Because, you know, we hope to bring out the best in you and help you achieve those aims that you've set yourself, and also help you to forget the experiences that you had.
When I was 8 years old, I saw a group of soldiers were about to execute a man. My legs were shaking like jelly, because I saw them while they were killing that man. The blood was coming out of his body like water running from a tap. I was really shocked. It hurt me inside, but I couldn't talk. You might have seen pictures about my country on your news, about the war, the terror, and the cruelty, but I saw these horrible things really happening in front of me. The memories will haunt me forever. After that day, I never went outside. I could hardly see my friends. You could smell the dead people lying around the street, rotting. Everyone was scared to go outside and bury them because they thought they are going to be the next prey of the soldiers. The husband of one of my aunties was taken by Mujahideen soldiers, and a week later they sent us the dead body. Mujahideen bombs kept dropping on Kabul. Nearly all the houses in our streets have been flattened. Another one of my aunties and her husband were killed. They never done anything wrong, and we don't know why they were the ones who've been killed by this bombing. In 1996, the Taliban government took over, and they were even worse than the Mujahideen. They assassinated President Najibullah from the United Nations headquarters, and they beat him and hanged him. I went to see his body hanging in a square.
Mayor, I can say, when the Taliban was on. You know, everywhere people are dying, you have to, you know, women have to cover their faces and hands and legs, you know. Even, don't know, it just, it was a nightmare, I can say.
The Taliban's treatment of women was very bad. They were beating women and punishing them if they did not obey the Taliban's order.
Then, it was like, I don't know how long, but they take my dad away somewhere. I don't know why.
The Taliban were hunting for anyone who had ever worked for the democratic government before the Mujahideen, which meant they were looking for my dad. They killed his friends and put him in prison. In jail, the Taliban were beating my dad, and he thought he was going to die. One of his relatives was able to pay large ransom to one of the Taliban to release him. One of my dad's relatives paid some human smugglers tens of thousands of pounds to get all of us out of Afghanistan and take us somewhere safe.
Somebody came to us and said, your dad is waiting somewhere. And I don't know what was happening. I thought we were going somewhere else, you know, some corner of Afghanistan. But when we met that, my dad, and he said, we're getting out of this place. I was happy, to be honest. I just wanted to get out of the place that before I end up dying.
We had to leave in the middle of the night. We had no choice, and it was the most terrifying journey of my life. We had to take horses and walk for days and days with hardly any food or water.
Now it takes like 5 months, I think, to get here. It was agent who was taking us, you know. He was leading us, like, not just us, you know, he had some more families, like two or three families together. We take everything, we walked, we were on, you know, we walked in the waters, getting the lorries and stuff.
They treated us like a herd of animals. They were acting like terrorists. They were beating and killing people who didn't obey their instructions. They were giving injections to the children to make them be quiet. Once in a boat, there was a child crying, and they were trying to give him an injection, but the mother didn't let that, and they threw the baby in the river and killed that baby. And we couldn't say anything at all because we were scared that they might kill us as well. One time, me and my brother were put into the boot of a car. We couldn't see anything, but we knew the car is going very fast, and we were very scared. At last, we reached Britain, and our nightmare was over. It was the first time for a long time that we had been treated like human beings and not animals.
And whenever I think of my country, when I think the difference between my country and this country, always like come to this place, we look above to the sky, like at the moon, the stars, and other stuff. We look all around and just think, how lucky people in this country are. They are the luckiest people ever I've seen. This place is really a good place to live because they accept your human rights. And being in this country feels something like I'm in paradise or something. I hope they'll never see the tanks, the rockets, the child soldiers, and some of the like slavery other stuff. I hope they will never see this kind of stuff. I'm always like looking up the moon and this makes me think. And the things I have just now, the friends, the life, the school education I'm having just now, makes me feel a lot better.
Hey, hey.
Hello.
Hiya.
This is Jamie.
This is Fuad.
I know I'm Fuad.
I know I'm Jamie.
And this is, what's it? Fuad and Jamie Show.
Yeah.
We are good friends, are we?
Yeah, no, best friends. Yeah. What do you like about school?
You.
What do you not like about school?
You.
See, best buds.
I first met Jim O'Neill at school through the buddy club set up to help bilingual pupils. He has been a great friend to myself and Abdullah.
Right, Jesus' dad, right, was, well, not his real dad, his dad was God, right, and that's, but his mum, Mary, right, and Joseph, who was our partner, was, they were looking for a place to stay, and they went through all these places, and they said, no, you can't come here, we're too full, can't come here, we're too full, but Mary knew that she's going to have the Son of God, like his angel Gabriel told her, and then that was, he was Jesus Christ, that's Christmas Day, that's the day he was born.
See, when I grow up, I want to be like Ali G.
How?
Because he talks all about all the woman.
Woman?
What? You're always looking for girls.
Who?
Yeah.
When?
You should be like me and Abdullah, just get one or two. Remember your mother seen this one?
Oh, I'm sorry if I sound cheeky.
You are the one who's going out with Emma Bunty.
Who's Emma Bunty? Nobody told me to feel so good. Nobody said you'd be so beautiful. Nobody warned me about your smile. You're the light when I close my eyes. Come. Let's talk about the birds.
What kind of birds are you talking about? The birds that will fly in, or the birds... the birds who were talking in Glasgow.
You don't mention
Glasgow,
that birds.
The girls.
It's getting hard in here. Take back. No.
No, don't hurt me.
See, in my country, right, our teacher used to hit you with the stick.
But with wood?
Ah, you know, they took the stick off, and when they took the stick, it's wet.
Excuse me.
The inside is wet. You know, when you open it, you're... It's like, oh.
Don't
hit
me.
Just try it. Watch. Honestly.
Go like one. That. Like that.
Nah, it won't hurt that like that. Look, yeah. See you?
No, but they used to do that here. They used to have what?
They used to have big belts, you know.
In Afghanistan, you said no one would be out in the street together, like boys and girls.
There might be, listen, there
might be, but they don't go and kiss to each other on the street.
So this is the main thing. In our country, like, girls on one side, even schools, boys on the other side. They're always separate.
And if we'd done this here, the girls would complain. Well, they do what they want.
I know. Well, in here, it's equal rights. Come on, you can do it. Believe in yourself. Somebody give them a ball.
Nowadays, I think people doesn't like Muslims.
What do they not like?
No, because when I was small, I was thinking, when I see Christian people, I think, they become Muslim, you know, they are bad people. But when I came here, I realized that, you know, they're not all the people have got different religions and different people have got different beliefs.
But if you don't know any different from your own religion, and you just see all these people out there who believe another religion, then obviously you're going to think, oh, they're different, and anything that's different, people are a wee bit scared of.
There's one thing, arranged marriage and love marriage. Well, our country has always been arranged marriage. You don't say, I love that girl, you say, I want to marry that girl, and the,
if
after
she
that,
she doesn't want to marry you.
Well, that's an arrangement. That's how it works. It works pretty good.
But what if you hate each other?
Well,
I
yeah, not only
trust my parents to pick someone. So, but how can you marry a girl when you've not
met
her
like, before? It's a cultural thing in my country. If your mom knows and your dad knows that girl is really cool, good girl, and you know she can do everything, every house stuff, so you married her.
and they also show you the picture nowadays.
So when would you marry a girl? What age would you be?
Well, it's up to the boy. Parents. I want him to get married.
If it's up to you, you would marry right now, man.
No, 28. Because I want to finish my education. That's not funny.
Gonna dunk it.
Some people say a bunch of Muslims, a bunch of terrorists. But what I'm saying, instead of slagging them all or hate them all, why don't they just see who is, who is not?
Are you scared of us?
No. No. Yeah, but if I didn't know yous, and I was reading newspapers and say, oh, there's this guy in London or somewhere preaching to people to go and join, like, help start a war or attack places in Britain, then I'd be scared.
But Muslims all got the same belief, but they're not all the same. So that's why people should think who's good and who's bad.
So, but here, girls don't, but they wear short skirts.
Oh, yeah. I see no changes. All I see is racist faces. Misplaced hate makes disgrace to racists. We under. I wonder what it takes to make this one better place. Let's erase the wasted.
I've suffered racial abuses here in Glasgow. We would see swearing on the walls, telling us that asylum seekers are not welcome here, telling us to go back to our country. They are throwing eggs at us in bags of water from above.
This is the football pitch outside my flat that me and my friends used to play football. Now we cannot play football here because we are worried to get hurt. In the past, when we were playing football, some people used to stone us with this size or this size of stones. Like one night when we were playing football, one guy had thrown me this size of stone on my shoulder, and I still got the scar, and it was really painful. Rather than playing football in here now, we're going to play basketball.
You are living with the feel of getting stabbed, or being chased, or being battered, or silencing, or a kind of fish that's out of its water. So they're gonna try to make themselves the way the other people look, so the other people won't be racist to them.
Luckily here in Scotland, the police help get rid of violent people, and it's not so bad now. Compared to the nightmares I've seen in Afghanistan, this is nothing. It's not everybody in Scotland who hates us. Some people here have made a big effort to get to know us, and we are trying to understand them and want to be friends with them.
People think it's funny if they see things that aren't the same as what they've been brought up as, and they don't like it. Nobody likes change. But sometimes you need change, and that's what I did. That's what Fo did. That's what Abdullah did. Everybody changed to suit each other. But there is people who didn't. And they're the ones that miss out in there because they don't get to know each other. They grow up thinking the same things. And they don't learn anything new.
It's great to celebrate Eid. It is like a kind of Christmas for Muslims. So we invited some of our friends right to my house.
Even the worst enemies in this day, they have to talk again.
I think we didn't talk for a month or something, a month. We didn't talk with each other in it, yeah, never. Then it was Eid.
No, so that.
His big brother came and he's like, look, man, today is Eid. You gotta get back with each other. If you are Muslim, and if you fall out with someone, if you pass the Eid like that, you know, falling out with your friend, that would be really, really bad scene. Anyway, it's the Muslims' happiest day. This is the Holocaust exhibition thing that I and Abdullah have been working on for like more than a month with another 30 people with us, you know, it's in mainstream, also refugee people who was working with. I didn't know anything about this Nazi or Germany was killing more than 12 million people, my Jews died, more than 12 million being killed. And when I heard about it, I just get, what, how horrible would someone be, and I couldn't imagine. Now, I knew it was happening in my country, but I didn't think it was happening in the past.
And the reason we've done this is because we just want to show people, like, the Holocaust was, from 1937 till 1945, and the same thing is happening till now. It doesn't, not, it might not seem to people it's happening, but this is happening. People are dying, millions and millions of people are still dying in lots of countries like Iraq, Burma, the Balkans, in Afghanistan, African countries, some Asian countries. And these are all the evidences we can show, and the figures we found out. We got all evidences, even up to 2001, what was happening all around. And the other reason we've done this, like, some people doesn't know why asylum seekers come to this country. And the reason we want to show it is because of all this stuff is happening. The war, the starvation, or to have children like this. And that's why all they are here, just to get a secure life, not for anything else.
Still seeing the same stuff, and on and on. Even though we think this finished and it passed, and we're making a memorial day of it, but it's not. I mean, today we're seeing that America trying to go to war with Iraq, which is not with me. You know, I don't really agree with it. Not to worry, you can sit down and talk and do a peace. There's a quote, it's here. Peace cannot be achieved through violence. It can only be achieved through understanding. So you gotta understand the people's situation. You gotta understand what most people were like.
Tonight we went to an Afghan concert. The performers were a woman and a man.
A lady and a gentleman, a couple.
That's better.
It was really good. I wanted to cry, to be honest. Thanks to Scotland.
Yeah, thanks a lot. We never thought that you're gonna see stuff like this in a country that's not ours, but now I feel like...
I appreciate that. You know, Scotland is... There is only one Scotland, and there will always be one Scotland.
So now I feel like I'm in my homeland, you know? Seeing stuff like that in a country like this, I feel like I'm in my homeland. And thanks to the people who are organizing stuff like that. Something from it.
Because we certainly did, and we were making it.
In Scotland now become like our second home.
And the peace can be achieved through the understanding, not through the violence.
And we wish the world peace. See you after.